Season 4 of Notebook on Cities and Culture is brought to you by Daniel Murphy. Polar Inertia, a journal of nomadic and popular culture online at polarinertia.com, and Medivate, a community and set of tools to help you build the kind of meditation practice you'd like to have, online at medivate.com.
Like to start off at the intersection of 9th and Flower on these tours of mine because I like people to see what the neighborhood can become from nothing, basically. So where we're standing here at 9th and Flower in South Park, which a lot of people think of mostly as the Staples Center and LA Convention Center, it actually goes up all the way to 8th Street and all the way down to the 10th Freeway. Here where we're standing in front of Ralph's Supermarket, the neighborhood that we're standing in now didn't exist, you know, prior to 2007. And so when I first moved down here in 2006, there was no grocery store. There was obviously no Starbucks across the street from us. And all the buildings that really kind of surround us right now that are residential, you see the Apex Tower there, the Watermark Tower, Ritz-Carlton, 717 Olympic, even behind us right here, Ralph's Market Lofts. These are all brand new, and I just think that's really amazing that there was nothing here, and now you have an entire neighborhood in the making. And I think it's just really exciting for people that are downtown LA boosters because, well, there was nobody here at one point. Now it's activated. You see people walking on the sidewalks. There's people biking, walking their dogs. As you see across the street, people at Starbucks are sitting outside enjoying a cup of coffee. And, you know, it's really adding an urban lifestyle to Los Angeles that did not exist before. And so that's why it's so exciting for us here in LA to have something like this now. And I usually like to start off here because this is really brand new.
It is Notebook on Cities and Culture. I'm Colin Marshall on a downtown walking tour here in Los Angeles with Brigham Yen, who comes at Los Angeles from two different directions. He's a realtor and a blogger. He's got a blog very popular, DTLA Rising, documenting the rising of downtown Los Angeles. You know, I wonder, the downtowns in America, all of them get talked about to an extent as coming back these days from nothing. Did downtown Los Angeles, is it coming back from a nothinger state of nothing?
Well, downtown LA was the birthplace of Los Angeles, El Pueblo, up by where Chinatown and Union Station is. So essentially, at one point, downtown Los Angeles was something. This is where all the shopping was, along Broadway, along 7th, along Hill. People came into the city to work. This is where the center of Los Angeles was when the city was just starting. And so obviously with the advent of the automobile, when there was cheap oil, suburbanization took hold of the country and people started fleeing the city centers. And so, you know, downtown Los Angeles as a result died, and all the shopping was sucked out of downtown. Out to shopping centers, shopping malls, people depended on parking more and more. And downtown tried to compete with that and knock down a lot of beautiful historic buildings just to pave over them with surface parking lots. And as a result, we know that how that happened. What happens with that? It, you know, the city died. And so now we are really coming back from nothing for the last 50, 60 years. And shopping's coming back, dining's coming back, and more importantly, I think, residential's coming back.
And which direction shall we head to get a feel for this?
Let's head east along 9th Street, and we could head over to the historic core, just because I feel like that's a really exciting part of downtown LA redevelopment, because a lot of shops, I believe, will be coming there in the future, and we just talked about shopping coming back into the city. Well, Urban Outfitters just started construction on their Rialto Theater space, which is really exciting.
And how long was that empty, unusable, disused, whatever you want to call it, that space?
From my understanding, it's been used as sort of a swap meet storefront for, my guess is, several decades. And, the building was dilapidated, falling apart, and it's a theater. It's a historic theater, the Rialto. And so Urban Outfitters is going to put in a lot of money to bring back the beautiful marquee and really bring back the entire structure and rehab it.
Now, how far do you go back in life with the city of Los Angeles? What's the beginning of your engagement with the city as a whole, downtown or otherwise?
Well, I grew up in the suburbs of Los Angeles in the San Gabriel Valley. And, I didn't start coming to downtown until I was, basically in college. And
downtown was then what to you?
Downtown was fascinating, but dead. And I think that's what contributed to the fascination, because here you were in the second biggest city in the country, but our downtown was empty and was a ghost town. And I went to school up in the Bay Area, experienced San Francisco, which is a bustling and vibrant. And I would come back to LA and kind of wonder, where was our San Francisco? And going to New York as well, would come back, where's our New York? Where's our urban center? Why does all the centers of commercial activity in Los Angeles take place in shopping malls? Behind, internalized shopping centers. And so that was always the question that was on my mind. And I just really wanted to see downtown Los Angeles become a real city center.
And you had a sense then that it could be that, right? What gave you the inkling that it could come back to the way it was 80, 90 years ago?
I think because it has really good bones. It has a lot of the infrastructure in place. It's a commercial grid akin to San Francisco or New York. It's got a mass transit network here, the Red Line, Purple Line, Expo Line now, and the Gold Line coming into Union Station. We're going to start on a streetcar system as well. So it had really good bones, and it looked like other city centers that I've seen before, the historic buildings, the tall skyscrapers, but it just was missing, people. It wasn't energetic. There's nothing here. But you know that if it has good bones and you nurture it, it'll grow and it'll become a great center.
Now, from 9th and Hope here, where do you usually head on your walking tours?
Well, let's cross the street across Hope. We'll cross and pass by Grand Hope Park. And that's another thing in downtown LA that we're building more and more of, are public parks. Just several weeks ago, about a month ago now, Spring Street Park opened over by 4th and Spring. And that was a great amenity, public space added to downtown Los Angeles. And of course, we have Grand Park up by the Music Center, and the very exciting news that the state office building by the city hall was purchased by the city of Los Angeles. So that will add another 2 acres of public space to LA, downtown LA.
How do you balance what you look at, public space versus private space, going up skyscrapers versus parks? What do you instinctively pay the most attention to for yourself?
I think it's very important to have a combination of public-private. I think in Los Angeles, what we lacked was good public space. We have lots of great private space. I mean, Los Angeles is known for our beautiful mansions and beautiful homes, architecturally speaking. But we were missing great public space that so many other cities across the world have. Anywhere from Europe to Asia to many parts of North America, great public space is where public discourse happens. It's where the exchange of ideas happen. It's where people get really kind of intellectually stimulated by that
places
dynamic.
Nobody has to invite you into.
Exactly. Just kind of where we're standing now. We're standing on a public sidewalk. There's people kind of walking past us. We sense the energy of the city. And it's that vibrancy that was missing in Los Angeles on the public space front that I think we're starting to finally gain back.
Why do you think the public spaces went away or never appeared?
I think it's the way that Los Angeles developed around the automobile. You know, many cities kind of have that set up. The Southwest and many parts of the United States are very car oriented. And whenever you have a model where the car is the only way you're going to get around, parking becomes an issue. Parking is very expensive. So surface parking lots are generally the rule. And
looking at one right now across from the street from this park, we have a surface parking lot. And I wonder, when will these things go away?
Well, this one actually, this parking lot across from Grand Hope Park is actually slated to become a 33-story residential skyscraper.
Days are numbered.
So, yeah, eventually what we're staring at right now, which actually dotted the entire landscape of South Park, will become a new gleaming residential high-rise and adding more residents to downtown Los Angeles, more retail. Like I mentioned before, Watermark, 717 Olympic, that whole group of high-rises that were at 9th and Flower, that are at 9th and Flower, they were basically parking lots at one point, just like the one that we're standing across from right now.
I read a book on Los Angeles from 1996, I think. It said that downtown was then 50% parking lots. Dude, does that sound at all plausible to you?
Oh, absolutely. I think we haven't really made as much progress as we think or we should have. I think downtown LA is still mostly parking lots. And, you know, parking lots really kind of suck away pedestrian life because, you know, it's irrelevant to pedestrians. It's it doesn't add anything to the community. It actually just takes away. And so the more we do infill these parking lots with high quality mixed use projects or public space like parks, the more vibrant, the more pedestrian oriented downtown Los Angeles will become. And counterintuitively to people, that taking away the parking lots and adding quality mixed use will actually liberate us from driving. So we won't depend on driving as much because the environment will be more conducive to walking. And that's what happens when you have a great urban center. You don't need to park or drive because it's all built out, it's mature, and walkable.
Now, as we continue walking, I'll ask you this. You mentioned growing up in the suburbs of Los Angeles, and I grew up in the suburbs of Seattle. Both of us probably had the same situation where it was a sort of drive-everywhere mode. And at least for me, I knew it was unsatisfactory on some level, but I wasn't really aware of what other way life could be. Did you have the same condition?
Absolutely. I actually did not know the difference between urban or suburban until I moved up to the Bay Area. And I still remember my first time going to San Francisco and just kind of perplexed by the way the city looked. It didn't have parking lots everywhere. There were stores underneath buildings and there were people walking around everywhere. And I would see, you know, San Francisco does have a lot of single family residences. They're just kind of packed in a lot closer. And it was really strange to me that they didn't have yards in the front like we have here in the suburbs of Los Angeles. So
what do they mow?
Yeah, exactly. So then I started, you know, realizing that, you know, it was much more an efficient land use policy that they have in San Francisco that allows people to walk and be able to access things more efficiently. And so I came back to LA, and that's when I found downtown had those great bones, because it has a great stock of historic buildings, and it's dense, it's relatively compact compared to the rest of Los Angeles. And so yeah, I had the same issue. I would drive around, you know, and I actually at one point was very proud of our freeway network.
Some of them look cool. You have to admit that they're achievements. I mean, but we didn't really know what would go wrong with them at the time.
I agree. I mean, suburbia itself is an experiment. It's so young, you know. A lot of the people of this generation think that it's always been like this, but It is a very, very new experiment in urban planning. And more people in the world live an urban lifestyle than they do a suburban lifestyle. And I think we're finally starting to realize the negative impacts that suburbia can have on our social and environmental economic lifestyles.
Was San Francisco for you the beginning of your interest in cities as a subject?
Yes, actually, San Francisco, and even more so when I took a trip to New York in college, and really, New York was the epitome of what urban is. And when I set foot in Penn Station for the first time, I had a tingle down my spine, which I've never felt before. And I went out of Penn Station and walked around, and I was so just thrilled and fascinated by what Manhattan just showed me. It was just bustling with life, and there's people everywhere, shops galore, and it was nothing like I've ever seen before. And at that point on, I realized that there was truly a difference between what urban could be, you know, akin to Manhattan or San Francisco, and what suburbia is back in Los Angeles here, you know, that so many, most people still live in today.
We have kind of a symbolic view here on Grand and Ninth. Surface parking lot, crane behind it,
yes.
Something's going up, then old buildings behind that.
Yes.
Three layers going on, what's going away, what's coming, and then what hopefully we can preserve.
Yes, well, this we're standing at 9th and Grand right now, right by FITM, and yeah, in our point of view right now, we see a crane rising. A 32-story tower being developed by Ani Group is under construction, and it'll add several hundred new residents to this area. And just up the street on Grand, actually, looking north, Whole Foods is coming, actually, and I think that's very exciting, because Whole Foods has a fantastic reputation. It'll attract more capital investments into downtown, I believe, when they do formally announce. And the project that they're going into right now by Carmel Partners from San Francisco is going to add 700 units of housing to this area. So within the next couple of years, several years, these parking lots will now be new residential towers, and they're going to add thousands of people here. And it'll activate the sidewalks. People will come out of their units and walk on the sidewalks, walk to the grocery store, walk to the shops, take our streetcar around, and basically live the urban lifestyle.
Now, shall we cross Grand?
Colin, I wanted to point out on Grand and Ninth is the linear park that was planned for Grand Avenue between 9th and Olympic at one point in front of FITM.
So part of the street would become a park in this plan.
Yeah. Several years ago, downtown LA competed for, I believe it's Prop 84. Don't quote me on that. I think it's Prop 84 grants from the state to build a linear park here. And unfortunately, we didn't win the money. But I believe that this section can incorporate what's going to happen along Broadway in the next several weeks, which we're getting a road diet on Broadway. Four lanes are going to go down to three.
I underscore the name of that phenomenon, or the name of that project, Road Diet.
Road Diet, yeah, which downtown LA needs a lot of.
The city is in its entirety.
Exactly. Arguably the entire city, but downtown LA especially, since it has the most potential for being pedestrian-oriented. Our streets are obese. They're very wide. It's almost like a highway's cutting through, and they really take away from having an intimate pedestrian-oriented environment to walk in. And here and Broadway, they're going to incorporate what New York has done, where they do a more economic way of closing off streets. They basically repaint the asphalt a different color, put up some bollards and some planters, and that allows pedestrians to now reclaim that part of the street. And so this part of the road in front of FITM would have costed, you know, I think $6 million or something to completely redo this into a park. However, we could do it at a fraction of the cost if we went with the way New York has done it, which is just paint it a different color, add some bollards and planters, put in some chairs and tables, and there you go. You have reclaimed public space for pedestrians.
You talk about incorporating an innovation of New York, but What New York is, of course, going to be on this list, but where? What cities are best, do you think, for or most suitable for downtown Los Angeles to learn from?
I think you take bits and pieces from many different cities because every city is kind of doing their own thing. And what I like to do is I like to look at cities that are already on the path of redevelopment and urbanization because we can learn from them. Let's not reinvent the wheel. Let's take it because ultimately we have a grid here. That's nothing unique. We have buildings here. That's nothing unique. Mixed use. So let's look at other cities and see what type of innovative ideas they're coming up with. And instead of trying to look at life in Los Angeles in a vacuum and not look outside. Let's be smart about it. Let's be efficient. Let's look at what other cities are doing. Philadelphia, Boston, San Francisco, Denver, New York, Vancouver, Toronto, all these cities are doing marvelous things. And let's take those ideas and incorporate them here.
What kind of cities are really impressing you as far as those types of projects? Which ones just strike you personally as, hey, you know, that could be fruitfully tried out here?
Well, for me at least, the most recent one was when I was in New York a couple of months ago. And those pedestrian plazas that they have where they took it back from the street, I think that's the most relevant here in Los Angeles. Because our streets are so wide, we have so much space to play with. And so here in Los Angeles, we don't have a lot of public space. And our sidewalks are relatively so narrow compared to our streets. So what does that say about this society? It means that this society cares more about cars than they do about people. And so taking from New York, I know a lot of people, you know, let's not just look at New York, let's not look at other cities, but let's take that idea and incorporate it here in LA because I think we need it. We need more public space. And our roads are perfect places to start because they're so wide.
Right. Now, I take it you have a similar answer that I do when friends ask me, out-of-town friends, bemusedly ask why I would choose to live in Los Angeles. Usually I say, I mean, there's a lot of possible answers, but one of them, the one that gets the most traction is, this is the city changing most in America. It's the sort of the changiest city. The pure change fascinates me. Would you say the same of yourself?
Yes, I completely agree. I think because Los Angeles was, and maybe to a lot of people still is, the poster child of the auto-oriented society.
I've never been to Phoenix.
Exactly, but we are the epitome of that. We're gigantic. We're a region of 17 million people. There's a lot of mass here, and this inertia is headed towards driving. That's what it's always done. But now there's a change in direction, which I think the rest of the United States is looking at us curiously. I think if Los Angeles can show that we can become more pedestrian oriented, other cities like Phoenix or Las Vegas or Houston, Dallas, all of these other really car oriented cities, they could look at us and say, wow, if Los Angeles can do it, sure enough, we can.
There's that sentiment. If even Los Angeles can do it,
even if LA can do it, we can do it.
Yes. As I recall talking to you before about your interest in cities and its genesis, a glimpse of Salt Lake City also impressed you. Is that correct?
Well, I'm a little biased because I am from Utah. So Salt Lake City, they are going through the same phenomenon naturally because it's a national force right now, downtown revitalization. So Salt Lake City did bring back a lot of shopping. They created a mall there called City Creek Center. Which brought back a lot of shopping to downtown Salt Lake City. And they have, I believe, two Apple stores, a Tiffany & Company, Porsche Design, Banana Republic, J.Crew, a lot of the names right now that are absolutely missing from downtown L.A. Mm-hmm. And I think in order to successfully bring relevancy back, commercial relevancy back to downtown L.A., we have to attract retailers of that caliber back to the city.
It seems to me the way the order has gone here is first the transit came back, then maybe the eating came back, the restaurants, then I don't know what comes next, the grocery stores or the shopping? What's the order here that the elements return?
You hit it right on the nail, right on the head. I mean, it is definitely first transit. You know, We had office back in the 80s. We have transit. Eateries came back because I think you don't really have to shop for eating. You just, right. It could be destination oriented.
Were the bars back first, or were they together, bars and eateries?
Bars and eateries. Okay. I mean, Pete's Cafe over at 4th and Main has been there since the beginning of this downtown revitalization. Wow. And so, but you're right. The next phase is definitely going to be grocery stores and shopping. As I said, stated earlier, Whole Foods is coming back. Urban Radish just opened up in the Arts District. There are Smart and Final Extra is opening up next week. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of grocery stores now finally coming back. I'm looking at you, Trader Joe's, next. Basically, shopping is going to be next. And Urban Outfitters is coming, Zara, Sparkle Factory. Lots of cool, interesting stores are coming back.
Now, what have we on this corner of 9th and Hill where we stop?
9th and Hill, I think the most exciting thing right now that happened recently is Stocking Frame here is a new restaurant bar that just opened up this past weekend. Many people may know Lola Gasper in Santa Ana. It's the same owner, Jerry Ashoff. And so it's a really cool restaurant bar here. There's nothing, again, on this intersection. And so to have this restaurant come here, it's going to activate this corner and hopefully bring some more life back into this intersection.
Tell me what it means to you to activate a part of a city. What does that imply when you say something is activated?
Human energy. Without human energy, there's no life. And so you can have all the buildings in the world, and we've all seen those zombie apocalyptic films of Manhattan where Manhattan is empty. We all know that the buildings are only part of the picture. You have to have people walking around, jogging, doing their day-to-day activities, interacting with, engaging with the city. And that's what we mean by activating, that there are people using the city, going to the stores, going to the dry cleaner, going to work, going shopping, going eating. And, you know, it's having people walk on the sidewalks. And the only way you're going to have that happen is when people start opening up businesses, people start living in that environment, and the interaction with the city just naturally starts to happen because, you know, people have to go to work, they have to go eat, they have to go shop.
I forgot to mention one of those things when I said that the layers that come back, transit, office, eating, bars, living spaces, of course, that's got to be an early thing as well, right?
Oh, yeah. Basically, in the downtown revitalization, we did forget to mention that. It wasn't just eating or now the shopping. The residential was actually the key to making this picture all happen. Residential came in after the adaptive reuse ordinance was passed in 1999, and Tom Gilmore was one of the first developers to take advantage of that. And he developed three wonderful loft buildings at 4th and Main, the Hillman, San Fernando, and Continental buildings, 230 units. And that was the first experiment and foray into this new urban, you know, territory. And people were very skeptical that it would work. Who would want to live in Skid Row? Who would want to live in downtown LA, the most dangerous place in America?
Who not in the tent would want to live
exactly
here?
And but obviously now we have shown all the skeptics and proven them wrong, that there are plenty of people who want to live in an urban environment in Los Angeles.
Now, for those following along, where does the Brigham Young walking tour of downtown take us next from 9th and Hill here?
We're going to go eastward towards Broadway. We're here on Hill. And Broadway is really the next coolest thing of downtown LA. I think it is going to be one of the coolest streets in North America.
Really?
It is so rich in history and architecture and just so much culture there that I think when we start to really refurbish all the buildings and bring back those movie palaces and find a use for them again, bring back the shopping, the streetcar, the road diet we talked about, I really believe Broadway is going to become one of the most just valuable streets in America.
Let's head over to it. At Broadway, it seems to me, it's always had some sort of energy to it. That ember never really completely went out on Broadway, did it?
No, you're right. It didn't. At Broadway was one where at least there were always people coming here. It's just the demographics and the uses evolved and changed over time. Obviously, when suburbanization sucked most of the mainstream retailers out of Broadway, they were very quickly replaced by, you know, jewelers and swap meets and, you know, check cashing places. Gosh. And it's like a natural evolution. We see that in many cities across the country.
It narrowed down to serve one group, essentially.
Exactly. It basically became a place that only one group of people came to shop at. And many others felt like this wasn't relevant to them, and as a result, they stayed away.
Now, it's a subject we've talked about before, but it's one that I've thought about ever since. In that the strength of a city at its best is that it can combine, it can serve more groups at once than any other type of place can. It can offer more to a wider variety of people at once. It can have the Prada next door to the Fallas Paredes. You know, it's. That seems to me to be the main thing a city can do well. Do you think that's true?
I could not agree more, Colin. I actually love that idea of having a mix of different uses and retailers all next to each other. And that's the thing that I notice the most about when I go to New York. The mix of different stores, and I love how you said that. Prada right next to Fallas Paredes, you know, because it really is the magic of a city to bring in different types of people, and that's what keeps it balanced. And I think people have to realize that a healthy urban center is balanced. You don't want a place to become too much of one group. You don't want it to become ultra wealthy like Beverly Hills, and you don't want it to become too downtrodden, because then you're not going to be able to attract investment. Right. Back into the city. And so, but when you have a balance of different demographics coming to the city and engaging with it, interacting with it, it keeps people grounded. And I've noticed that people like a balance in a city.
How do you prevent a city from going all Prada once it gets to be expensive, like the way that downtown Los Angeles is getting more expensive all the time? It's not turning all Prada by any means yet, but
I think that a city generally goes, and even within a city, they go through their cycles. And so what happens is there will always be the next hottest area. The next hottest area is going to attract a certain demographic. There's going to be that area that was hot for a moment, and then it's going to kind of fade away a little bit, and it's going to attract another demographic. So it's always constantly in a cycle. And downtown Los Angeles is so gimungous from, you know, the 110 to the 10 to the river to all the way up to Chinatown. It is a really, really big place, geographically speaking. And I think that's exactly what was missing. It was completely imbalanced. We don't have Prada. We don't have Gucci. We don't have Louis Vuitton. And that, I think, is what downtown is missing. We have a lot of low end, but no high end and no middle end. We're still very, very far away from ever getting to a point where there's going to be too many Pradas and Gucci stores. So, you know, at that point, then we'll try to figure it out.
At this point, do we continue on Broadway or do we go on 9th?
I wanted to point out here, 9th and Broadway is a very important piece in the puzzle in the Broadway revitalization plan. Bring back Broadway, Jose Huizar's office calls it, because this is the epicenter of where most of the retailers are starting to come back. We have Acme Studios that is building their global flagship store here. They're a Swedish-based upscale clothing store. They only have one other in the country in Soho, New York, and they chose to open up here in downtown LA. And not only that, their largest store in the world, so bigger than the one in Stockholm. We have Angelo Home right next to it. This, by the way, is in the Eastern Columbia building. And Angelo Home is a fabulous furniture boutique store started by Angelo Sermelis. He was a HGTV host. And behind us here we have the Ace Hotel, which is under construction. And that is going to be a game changer for Broadway because, as anybody who's been to an Ace Hotel knows, it's really a trendy and chic, and it's really going to add a nice change to Broadway. And you have Sparkle Factory coming. Tarina Tarantino's Sparkle Factory is opening up nearby as well. And basically you have Umami Katessen, Urban Outfitters. They're all starting right here. So hopefully what's going to happen is going to ripple northward. And that's what we're seeing happening. And you have the May Company building that's on the market right now, which will be slated for a large mixed-use project, likely turning into a hotel, residential, and retail center. And that's 1.1 million square feet of space right there. So there's a lot of mass right there, and that's going to play an important role in the future of Broadway as well, that project, the May Company.
I think of what a hotel was downtown Los Angeles 10 years ago, and it was essentially like rooms for alcoholics to drop themselves into for a while. It was not the Ace Hotel, certainly.
No, certainly not.
That illustrates it all right there.
Yeah.
Now, 9th Broadway, where do we continue?
We can continue northbound. Okay. We're passing by the Fashion District that's further east from here. And northbound on Broadway, we'll pass by Spring Street and conclude there, where a lot of residents have moved in. And you'll see the amazing changes that have happened there as well.
Now, writing your blog, DTLA Rising, it gives you this sort of future vision where you can look around downtown and see not just what's here, but what will be here in 1 year, 2 years, 5 years in some cases, I'm sure. So what with DTLA Rising, what do you really want to deliver your readers most of all?
I want to deliver the excitement that Los Angeles is becoming an urban city, and that why should we be the oddball in the United States, you know, in the world? Why should we be the one global city that relies on the automobile and there's nobody on the sidewalks? I think, you know, a lot of people that come to Los Angeles, they immediately assume that, you know, it's like a New York, it's like a Paris, it's like a Tokyo. And they drive around La Brea, La Cienega, Beverly, and there's nary a pedestrian on the sidewalk. It's absolutely empty, and there's a confusion.
And not much to go to either on those streets.
Exactly. It's very inconvenient. There's no energy, and it feels very sterile. And that's why Los Angeles, for the longest time, was criticized as having no culture.
I think you as well as I have had many encounters with visiting foreigners, especially Europeans, who ask you, how do I get to this place? Where is the center of here or there? What's going on? Where? Just very disoriented questions they have, and it's kind of saddening, isn't it?
It is saddening because, again, like what I was saying before, many people think of Los Angeles because it's such a famous world city that it's going to be and behave like a great world-class city like Paris or New York. And they come here, and it's completely different from what they expected, and not in a good way. And they come here and they're just utterly confused. Where's the center? How do I grasp what Los Angeles is? There was that lack of the center that made people confused about Los Angeles. And I don't think that's healthy for the city.
Now, where did you first begin writing about cities? The first time you set down your observations about cities, here or otherwise, where was it? What were you observing? What were you getting down?
The first time I wrote about any city was actually Pasadena. I also love Pasadena. It's a little sort of town, a satellite city of Los Angeles, and it had many of the elements that I thought were great for an urban city. It's got, you know, a nice stock of old buildings. It's pretty walkable in the old Pasadena area, and it has a lot of quaint charm that I thought was really, really nice. So I wrote about that in a positive way, and I think that's where my feelings for urban centers and started to develop. And I just wanted to point out here, we are walking by Urban Outfitters, which is, as you can see, under construction.
Yes, indeed. It's slated for opening when?
Likely the end of this year or early next year.
Oh, I see. So it's a longer term
project.
Yeah,
it's a little bit longer, yeah. But you can see it's all boarded up right now, and they are starting construction. It's very exciting.
What has it been like for you to establish a sort of network of sources about downtown Los Angeles? People who keep you tapped in and whom, I guess, you keep tapped in about things as well. You know, what has that process been like for you? It seems to have happened fairly quickly.
Well, you know, I have been blogging for almost 5 years.
Right. And in internet years, that's a very long time.
Yeah,
that's
true. That's a long time in internet years. And I did start off working in economic development for the Downtown Center Business Improvement District in downtown L.A. And just working alongside a lot of property owners, a lot of brokers, both commercial and residential, gained a lot of contacts. And, you know, I worked directly with a lot of these people to bring in some of the earlier retailers and restaurants into downtown. So it kind of started from there.
Now, working in real estate as well as writing about the revival of an urban area, you have those two halves of your professional life. How do they interact?
You know, I really say they interact quite well, because the blogging about downtown L.A., it's so natural to then think about real estate, because you're blogging about buildings, you're blogging about the businesses, and you're blogging about the people moving in. And so the most logical sort of, you know, association with all of those are the real estate that is involved in that. And I found that to be very, very actually harmonious.
We're still going up Broadway. What should people know about?
We can actually head east towards Spring Street.
Excellent. For those following along, we're going towards Spring. Spring Street means what exactly for downtown?
Spring Street, I think right now, is the center of the residential life right now in downtown LA, because it's so dense with residential buildings. Many of the buildings have been converted to lofts, and so it's so interesting to come here on a Saturday morning, for instance, where you actually see the workings of an organic neighborhood. People are coming out, walking their dogs, they're jogging, they're going to the dry cleaners or going to the local cafe and grabbing a cup of coffee. It is
all
so
things
fast.
That sound normal, but they're new, you know, in a sense.
Yes, it sounds normal to everybody else who lives in an urban city elsewhere. But in Los Angeles, we didn't have that. We didn't have that in an urban context.
People might have done it in Venice, but that's 18 miles away, a completely different setting, non-urban, you know, beachside, a beach town. Right?
Exactly. I think, let me even elaborate even more, on an urban setting on a scale this large. I mean, we have little pockets of villages, but to be on a scale this large, it just never happened in Los Angeles.
I don't even, there seems to be even now too much to point out. You're the one with the, you're the one with the eye for this. What, when people walk the way we're walking, should their eye go toward, do you think, to understand, to learn the most, to observe the most about downtown Los Angeles? Look at the buildings, the people, the businesses, what's under construction or what's already thriving?
Yes, I think it's everything that you just listed right there. I mean, what is so exciting about the downtown revitalization is almost every single intersection you come to has something working there. Right. Whether it's apparent to you right now or not, there's something that's brewing there. And in this case, we're standing at 8th and Spring right now. And there is something apparently in the works. Taroni, which is a restaurant from Toronto, is building their flagship location here in Los Angeles. They have
Toronto
one.
Where the show will go later this season, by the way, listeners.
Yes. Oh, wonderful. Toronto's a great city. Taroni is slated to open in the next few weeks. And the build-out is incredible. This is going to be the next hottest restaurant in downtown Los Angeles. And it's right here at 8th and Spring. And so every intersection you come to, there's something wonderful happening. And I think that's why, I think for the skeptics, I just want to say it is happening. Because once you hit that critical mass, which is where we're getting to, it'll start to connect the dots. And then you'll be able to have more and more things open up next to all of these seeds planted and form that coherent urban sort of commercial district that engages people in the way that other cities in the U.S. have been able to do.
Now, when I write essays about Los Angeles and get feedback on them, occasionally you'll get the you'll get the rant back. I'll get the rant back. I'll have written something about how, you know, I wish there was more transit someplace, or I wish a part of Los Angeles was denser. Somebody will always say, well, that's because you've been brainwashed. You're a brainwashed millennial who has lower expectations for life and who is trained to want to live in a concrete box in the sky and not have their own yard or whatever. It sounds ridiculous when I say it like that. What's the most charitable way we could interpret an answer, comments like that? Because I'm sure you've heard them too.
I have, and my answer to that is the city is your backyard. And I rarely see people use the backyard every day unless they're growing a farm back there, which is wonderful if you are. But most people don't interact with their backyards or their front yards. And that's why if you were to go to suburbia and drive down any street, you will usually not see anybody at all on the street. Either they're jogging at the most, but nobody uses their front yard. Very few people use their backyard regularly. But a city, sure, you're living generally usually in a smaller unit, but the city is your backyard because you engage with it. And I prefer that. I can come out of my unit and immediately be engaged with an environment that's stimulating, that's exciting, that gets my blood going. And I don't usually think people feel that way when they step into their backyard.
Right. I don't think so either. But I just wonder what the best way is to assuage that Angeleno anxiety. You see, you know, people above a certain generation who have been here for a while worry that something important is being lost about Los Angeles. I don't know what, but what do you tell them just to allay the fears about it?
I think they should look at the virtues of urban planning done right when it's an urban environment. I think they're looking at it strictly from a suburban lens. And so in their mind, it's all about driving. It's all about parking. And
Especially about parking. Mostly free. Hopefully free, right?
Hopefully free parking. And in an urban context, that's not how it's supposed to work. Mm. When you're living in a dense urban environment that's walkable and serviced by mass transit, you're supposed to get around as a pedestrian. And when you do get around as a pedestrian, it's actually very convenient. And anybody who goes to a city like Madrid or London or New York can immediately sense how convenient it is to go from place to place. And I think if you were able to look at it through that lens, they might be more receptive to the idea. But, you know, it is very tough because there's already an ingrained culture here. There's a large mass of suburbia here, and people are always afraid of change. And so for me, I think we should be able to have it both ways. I mean, we're talking about downtown Los Angeles revitalization, which has no single-family residential homes in the vicinity. It's a place that we can build an actual true urban center to provide that balance in the area. If you go to New York, there's still people living in the suburbs. There's people in Connecticut, there's people in New Jersey. Hell, there's even houses in Queens, you know? But they have the balance of having a great urban center in that picture. And in Los Angeles, we only had suburbia. We didn't have urban. And I think for the suburbanites to really kind of impose their values on us, I think that's unfair. I think they should understand that there are people that want urban too, and we need a balance in Los Angeles.
Now, best to go north or south on Spring to see?
North.
North, okay.
So,
now, go ahead.
Yeah,
tell us a little bit about what we're seeing here.
North on Spring. This is generally where most people have been moving into in large concentrations of. There are thousands of residents that live on Spring Street, and as a result, you're starting to really see Spring Street as an experiment in downtown even. We had the parklets, two parklets that just opened up several months ago.
Literally that, very small parks.
Very small parks that take over a couple of parking spaces. We just had the Spring Street Park that opened up several weeks ago. Lots of boutiques are opening up on 6th Street, which is kind of like a little mini Melrose Avenue. Lots of independent boutique shops. You have the Last Bookstore, which is one of the coolest bookstores I've ever seen anywhere. And, you know, it's just a very interesting experiment in the making.
Now, as Los Angeles becomes more like New York or London or Paris or Tokyo, more like the other world cities, what are the Angeleno qualities you'd like to see it retain, or that it can't help but retain, or the ways you hope it stays different from those other cities?
I think, you know, we generally have a more laid-back culture, and that's likely due to the fact that we are a little bit more spread out. It's not so hustle bustle like London or New York or Tokyo. And you know, given the rail lines that have been completed, LA is always going to be a little different from those centers, because we have our multinodal model here. You have Century City and the West Side and downtown and Pasadena, but they're actually separated by large swaths of single family home areas. And so it's not like the other cities where it's contiguous urban development through its entirety. So as a result, even how Angelenos will get around in the future through rail and whatnot, it'll still be spread out more, so it's not as fast. So I think LA will likely retain its more laid-back atmosphere compared to those other cities in the world.
There's that sense of it being connected islands, kind of
connected
archipelago.
Islands,
I don't know what you'd call it exactly, but there you have it.
Yes, exactly. It's not a contiguous urban city throughout the entirety. And as a result, it'll always have a little bit more of a diluted urban energy to it.
Now, we've mentioned we're on one of the walking tours you give people of downtown Los Angeles, but there's many possible ones. I wonder, when friends are visiting from out of the city or the country, what do you find most important to have them see or do or walk through? I mean, the specific things, specific experiences you want to make sure they have to understand Los Angeles 2013.
I usually like to show people downtown LA, and specifically things that will remind them of great urban centers that they've been to, you know, because Los Angeles does have such a reputation for being suburban or, you know, lack of transit. So I like to take people to Spring Street. I like to take them to the Financial District and Bunker Hill. I like to show them that actually, you know what, Los Angeles does have now some great public space. We do have the workings of a great fledgling transit system. We do have streets that look and feel as urban as anywhere in the U.S. And being on Spring Street right now, I mean, you can see it and feel it. There's people walking on the streets. There's people sitting outside at the cafes. We're passing by a parklet.
Yes. There's exercise bikes mounted there in the concrete.
There's a sense of a true, authentic urban city as we're walking along Spring Street. And so on these tours, I just really like to show people that there is a side of Los Angeles that they actually are not aware of, that there's something just like the other urban centers that they're used to.
Now, what surprises them most about what they see, other than the fact that there are things like in other urban centers? And I mean, what do you sense really does catch people by surprise when you take them around? What sort of things, what sort of experiences, whether it's buildings they see or foods they eat or people that they see around?
I think the biggest surprise that people have when they come to downtown LA is that there are actually old buildings. Most people think of Los Angeles as the West Side, you know, the beach. They think of strip malls and houses. And when they come to the historic core, there are beautiful old historic high-rises here that I don't think people usually associate with Los Angeles. It's really, oh, it's got to be San Francisco, or it's got to be Boston, or, you know, Philadelphia, but it doesn't exist in Los Angeles. Los Angeles is too young. But I think, and I love to see people's reaction when they just stare up at the beautiful old buildings and just go, wow, this is really, really nice.
All this said about Los Angeles, what are your favorite other cities to visit and get different urban experiences than Los Angeles? You know, where do you go when you need a non-Los Angeles urban experience, and what do you draw from those places?
I really can go anywhere. I love to experience the small to the very large. I mean, I was just in San Luis Obispo not too long ago, And I really enjoyed walking around even downtown San Luis Obispo. It's very walkable.
It's more than you expect there.
Yeah, it really is. I was very surprised by how much retail downtown San Luis Obispo had. And I was very, very interested in downtown Brooklyn when I was there a couple of months ago, because they're going through a very similar stage in redevelopment there. They're revitalizing their downtown. And I got a lot of insight into what they're doing that could be applied here or give us a roadmap for our future.
What cities have surprised you? Big, small, anything in between? What places just made you think, I had a completely different set of expectations than what this place is doing?
I think Philadelphia really caught me by surprise. I didn't really know what to expect. I've heard a lot of negative things about Philadelphia before in the past. And I took a trip there last year, and I was very pleasantly surprised just how vibrant it was and how safe it felt walking around the downtown area.
What did they do right?
They just have a vibrant commercial center. It's vibrant. There's people everywhere. It's got a lot of young energy. There's nightlife, a great stock of retail. Really allows you to appreciate the architecture that's there now, because you can walk safely around and enjoy the city. And I just thought that was really surprising to me. Yeah.
Now, in the last 1 or 2 minutes we have, you know, we were standing here on Spring, we've been walking north. What should somebody following along on this tour, you know, maybe they're listening as they do it, what would you tell them to give them, you know, some parting words, some guidance for what they should explore next in Los Angeles, downtown or otherwise, what they should be aware of?
I think that they should be aware, number one, that downtown LA is evolving. So what you see right now will likely change. I mean, and right now it's all an experiment. I think it's going towards a really positive direction. But if you were to walk along Broadway and you still see a lot of maybe sort of disrepair, or it seems a little derelict, you know, just understand that downtown is evolving. It's changing. There's a lot of people that want to see it succeed now. It isn't just a niche group of people. It's becoming more mainstream. And just realize that it's really something special in Los Angeles. There's a place here in this vast ocean of suburbia where a group of people, like-minded people that are craving that urban dream, is really coalescing here in downtown and realizing it through their vision. They're building out their own stores, their restaurants. They're creating the art here, and they're living out their urban dream in the best way that they know in downtown Los Angeles. And all of that collectively starts to form this organic beating heart, like this beating organism, heart beating organism. It's really interesting, and I think that's the most the biggest drive for me to continue what I do is, you know, just seeing that there are now thousands and thousands of people that share the same dream that I had, you know, over a decade ago, of seeing downtown LA come back to life and really being able to walk again. And finally in Los Angeles, once we get this place going, you cannot say you can't walk in LA anymore. I think that'll be the most gratifying thing to me in the future, is to hear people say you can walk in Los Angeles and feel good.
I've been speaking here in downtown Los Angeles on a walking tour through downtown Los Angeles with realtor and blogger behind DTLA Rising, Brigham Yen. Brigham, thanks so much.
Thank you so much, Colin.
This has been Notebook on Cities and Culture. You can keep up with the cultural creators, internationalists, and observers of the urban scene on the show at colinmarshall.org. Thanks. Special thanks to everyone who backed Season 4 on Kickstarter, including Joel Neville Anderson, Daniel Levin Becker, Paige Calvert, Commander Manvark, Jonathan Crow, John Cunningham, David Dawes, James DeVito, Tim Dobbs, Paul Doyle, Jake Elliott, Kevin Emmett, Lawrence English, Jonathan Filbert, Andrew Philippone Jr., Michael Fransky, John French, Themistocles Eucrucius, Will Graham, Umberto Grant, Samuel Hansen, David Hayes, Jeff Hilnbrand, Mark Hines, Andrew Johnstone, Tadeusz Andrzej Kudlubowski, Peter Kavanaugh, Ted Kane, Andy Cooney, Evan Landman, Alfred Lee, James Maloney, Sean McDonald, Alberto Bruzos Moro, Jason Miller, Rob Montz, Daniel Murphy, Richard Nash, Aidan Nullman, Patrick O'Flaherty, Michael O'Regan, Christopher Porter, MJ Pritchett, Piers Rippey, Rob Schultz, Todd Shimoda, Cam Smith, Deborah Smith, Adam Sutherland, Maureen Kincaid-Speller, Anna Traher, Thomas Unterberger, Matt Warren, Nick Weigelt, Dion Wolf, Cynthia Yang, and Wayne Wright.